I was wrong about Harry Potter. I misjudged this character so badly. And it is right. I was wrong. There are often two ways people judge books. The first way is to follow the trend. Basically, be a sheep, okay? Just follow what everyone hates and follow what everyone likes. Basically, follow the rest of the herd and do not think for yourself, you know, because that you could risk retaliation or having an unpopular opinion, and you know, you could get socially outcasted. And that is one way people judge books. They basically just write the same stuff everyone writes about the book. And then there is another way where people judge books, and in that particular way, which I have happened to have fallen into, is people will have a particular opinion about books, right? They have an opinion of what makes a good story. And in that particular sense, what they will do is they will always, always, always be a zealot, right? Like a religious zealot about the opinion. This is what I believe, this is who I am, this is what I think makes a good story. And if you do not write exactly what I like, I consider you a terrible writer. In the first way, for instance, where people just follow everyone else like sheep, let's take Twilight for instance. The popular consensus is that Twilight is literally the end of the world. It's the worst book to have ever been written in the young adult literature, and it has some of the worst books. I do agree that the writing is bad. I do agree that the characters are amateur. But is it as bad as everyone makes it out to be? I would argue actually not. It's not as awful as people make it out to be. And it's not good. It's not good, but it's not as awful as people make it out to be. And a lot of people are just sheep about it and they just follow the popular trend. Number two, let's take my particular stance here, which I used to be, which is a zealot about what you think. And so this particular person will actually go the exact opposite of everyone else. They will have niche books that are absolutely hated by the popular, you know, consensus, but they have these books that they love and that do exactly what they believe a good story should be. And so that is the hole I have fallen into. And it is really difficult to admit that you are wrong. This is why conversations in politics do not progress. No one is willing to admit that they are wrong. Everyone wants to think that they are correct, and the other side is basically absolutely, absolutely evil. And they just want to win an argument. And I really want to hold myself to a higher standard because, first of all, I respect the fact that you're watching my YouTube channel. I respect the fact that you're watching my videos. I respect the fact that you are taking time out of your day to watch my channel. And that means you deserve someone who is respectful, someone who not only respects themselves, but also respects you and is willing to showcase a standard for, you know, sort of artistic judgment or reviews or books and so on and so forth, right? That is good. And in that particular sense, I want to hold myself to a higher standard, okay? And that means I need to point out my biases. I need to point out the fact that what I think makes a good story is not necessarily what everyone thinks. And that is how I have behaved up to this point with my YouTube channel. I have always, always, always treated my opinions as gospel. And this is true. If you go back to my YouTube channel, you will see that I'm always, 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 always talking about my opinions as if they are fact. And as if this is the correct way to tell a story, this is everything that we have to do. And if you don't do it, you are wrong. And I want to really go away and move away from that particular perspective. And this is the issue I have fallen into with Harry Potter. And the reason why I have realized this is actually a popular booktuber called Danielle Green. I've been watching Danielle Green for so long. In fact, I used to watch his videos back when he had just 20,000 subscribers. I didn't watch him like when he was starting out, like he had like 2,000 subscribers or 1,900, like I do right now. But the guy is an absolute legend, and he has always been an inspiration, and he has always been sort of a model, right? So like that pillar you should be aiming towards, right? And the reason why he has managed to change my perspective and my outlook on how to judge books is because Danielle Green has two philosophies with which he uses to review his books. If he reads a book and he's making a review, he will use these two things. And the first way is that he will talk about what makes, in his particular opinion, a good book. And he will judge the book that he just read, how well it does those things, which is generally speaking what I used to do. But the second thing that Daniel does, which is what I think is really, really special, and I think, you know, you'll notice it in a lot of his reviews, is that he will talk about what was the author trying to achieve with the particular book that he just read. And this is something I have never seen anyone do. Everyone in the world is screaming about what they think, and no one asks, what was the author trying to achieve? And I have only seen this in few people, and Daniel Green is the most prominent example of this. What was the author trying to achieve? And this is really, really something important that you have to understand, because it is the exact mistake I have fallen in with Harry Potter. And so when Daniel Green reviews his books, he reviews them that way. He will talk about what the book should have been done well and that he thinks is good, but then he will talk about what was the author trying to achieve. And I want to adopt this wholeheartedly into my, you know, behavior and how I look at books. And so in particular, let's talk about Harry Potter. What was J.K. Rowling trying to achieve? The thing that I believe wholeheartedly is that a story should always have a character arc. If a story does not have a character arc, it's not good. And this is not just a simple character arc. This is a dramatic change, internal dramatic change, not external, because Harry Potter goes through a lot of external change. Does he go through internal change? No. This meant in the past, when I looked at Harry Potter, I always saw him as a terrible character because he was a blank vessel for the, or blank vehicle for the audience, right? And he never interested me in any particular way because he does not change internally. He's always that angel, that little perfect angel. But with this particular perspective, let's incorporate into the question, what was J.K. Rowling trying to achieve with Harry Potter? Was she trying to create a character that changes internally in a dramatic way? Or was she trying to create a character that changes externally and grows up from childhood to sort of adulthood? And number two, was she trying to achieve a character that is acting as a vessel for the audience to sort of hop on and to experience the magical Hogwarts? And I think the answer is quite obvious for you here. The answer is that J.K. Rowling was trying to create a child who grows up in much the same way the intended audience would be going through those things, right? And so, in that particular sense, he grows up. Number one, objective completely achieved. Number two, in terms of being a vessel and a vehicle for the audience, how well does J.K. Rowling do this? In the beginning of this story, we established that, you know, Harry Potter is, in fact, quite special. He's not just a normal child. But then he is in an abusive household and in a little bunker, and so he is struggling. And you know that this child is good, and he's very kind, and he's very, you know, sort of, you just have to love the guy, okay? It's basically Harry Potter, I want to hug you. And you care about Harry Potter. And when he goes to Hogwarts, you come with Harry Potter. And all of a sudden he has friends and he is the chosen one and he's the special one, right? And that means Harry Potter is supposed to be a vehicle for the audience. So he is supposed to grow up, and as the series progresses, he grows up. And number two, he is supposed to be a vehicle for the audience. Does that happen? Absolutely. And how well does J.K. Rowling do this? She does this flawlessly. She does this better than anyone I've ever seen. Therefore, Harry Potter is one of the best written characters of all time. Why? Because it actually takes effort to achieve your task as an author that well. You want to achieve a task when you are writing a story. You achieve that task as well as J.K. Rowling, you are a flawless, epic writer. From here onwards with my life, you will be a standard with which I set myself towards. Because she could have given him an internal dynamic change, and that would have disrupted the second objective. It would have achieved the first objective very well, but it would have not achieved the second objective very well. And so with my YouTube channel, as I keep growing, as I keep, you know, learning, as I keep incorporating new aspects into the channel, I want you to hold me to this standard. I want you to remind me when I am being an asshole, basically. When I am just talking about one thing, and this is the correct thing, and this is how we have to do things. And when I don't take, you know, into consideration what was the author trying to achieve, right? I'm not talking about J.K. Rowling, J.K. Rowling. I'm talking about Harry Potter, Harry Potter. So yeah, I would prefer to separate these two things, okay? Yes, the person Harry J.K. Rowling and the person Harry Potter, the fictional character. This one is the one I happen to, you know, love. And so yes, thank you for watching. Have a nice day. And don't forget, in the future, if I mess up, please remind me. I'm always willing to learn. I'm always willing to improve. And I will always, 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 always do that. Have a nice day.